dope. Let's get it. I'm a trapping fanatic, that shit automatic, so I cannot turn it on or off. Bitches all on my dick, then she hop on my dick. I'm like, why you keep hopping on and off? Your bitch all on my dick, she be doing the most. I tell her, little bitch, she so extra. And my gun up on me, but I run up on me. Niggas, they wanna fight, they some breathless.
Naruto grew up with his elder sister Haku in a town near a ship dock that would take people from and to the Mist Village. Naruto grew up in a loving household, with his mother and father spoiling him at a young age. Haku, however, was more strict on her brother than her parents were. She didn't want Naruto to turn into a spoiled brat. He enjoyed this, as often the two of them would spar. Their mother and father were retired shinobi and wanted their kids to know how to defend themselves in case needed. Naruto was about 8 years old right now and was natural. Well, a natural prodigy at fighting. Everything seemed to come easy to him, which always made him work even harder to catch up to his sister, who is much stronger than him. Naruto was on the playground in his village with many of the other kids who would praise him. Naruto, you're so strong. Why don't you leave this rundown village? Why would I? I'm going to become the protector of this town, just like my old man. He's even stronger than me and my big sis. The kids then talked about Naruto's father and how they've seen him do amazing things. Months pass as the war going on does come to an end, but there still are many battles. For Naruto's 9th birthday, his father gives him a mission. He hands him a scroll and tells Haku to go with her brother to a town that's very far from here. They would pick up Naruto's gift in that town. This excites the boy, but Haku, well, she had a weird feeling about this. Her father never sends them from the village without their mother. She goes with Naruto, who leads the way, excited as ever. What do you think my gift is, Haku? I don't know. It could be anything, knowing our weirdo of a dad. Yeah, that's true. So you think he's weird too? I think it's kind of cool the way dad is. Well, I think it makes him stronger. Haku looks on at Naruto smiling. You want to be just like him, don't you? Naruto nods and they keep going forward. Naruto flips backwards but is still grabbed in the air by a rogue shinobi. Naruto, big sis, shut it, kid. Hand us everything or he gets killed. No, don't do it. You keep your mouth shut or I'll do it for you. Haku looks on, not knowing what to do. Thinking in her mind, if I attack him, Naruto might get injured. As she thinks this, Naruto's eyes widen, seeing another man sneak up behind his sister. No, sis, look out. Naruto's emotions and stress would peak at this moment as he unlocks something that's always been inside of him, something that separates Naruto from everyone else. Ice spikes then stab through each of the men and Naruto falls to the ground holding his chest. Haku runs over to ask Naruto if he's okay, but he says his body just feels cold. As she lifts his shirt, she sees dark ice spreading on his chest. No, this can't be good. This must be about the medicine that dad has him take. Naruto then passes out and Haku picks him up. As she turns around, but Naruto wakes up handing her the scroll. We have to keep going. He then falls asleep again, and she decides to head towards the other town on her own, traveling for days while her brother stays asleep. He's in a stable condition, but nothing seems to wake him up. Within the mind of Naruto, he was running away from the ice that was freezing everything around him. It would grab hold of his foot, and a being with glowing eyes roared at him. Naruto is killed in this nightmare and wakes up laying in a bed. Wait, where am I? An old man with no hair and a gray mustache then greets the boy. So you've awakened. Your sister has been worried sick about you. It's good she made it just in time so that you could begin. Begin what? Well, why do you think you were able to manifest ice? It's an ability passed down to you from your father and mother. Your sister, she can do it as well. Your father needed you to come to me because it's an ability that is a double-edged sword. Without the proper procedure, you will freeze your organs when using your own ice. However, this is a special procedure done so that you can use them without any drawbacks. So, wait, you did it already? The doctor then nods. Although there's something different about your ice, Naruto. Those strange markings that appeared on your chest. They were there during the procedure, but then suddenly vanished. There's something below the surface that you'll have to tap into. Yourself. What do you mean? Well, it's hard to say right now, but you are good enough to return home. Naruto gets up, thanking the man, and walks out of the room. His sister sees him and hugs him tight. She asked if he was okay, and he would smile. I'm better than I ever been. She ruffles his hair and then notices something different as she does so. In his dark hair, there was a strand of white pieces in it. What is this? Did you dye your hair too? No, I didn't. Why would I do that? That was there when I woke up. She calls it cool, and the siblings restock on supplies before heading back in the direction of their home. As they get close over the snowy hill, they see smoke. Haku wonders what this is, and Naruto runs forward. Sis, I think it's a fire. Let's go. Wait, Naruto. Haku chases after her brother, and as they get over the hill, they see their village on fire. They run in, and Haku helps the people by getting them out of their burning homes, and Naruto runs straight to his own. He slams his shoulder through the door, knocking it down. He looks up and shouts, "No!" Tears begin rolling down the boy's face as he would look up to see his mother and father covered in blood. Naruto runs close to his dad, who barely opens his eyes. Naruto. Damn it, son. I hate for you to see your old man like this. Dad, please don't die. Naruto hugs his father while listening to him speak. Listen to me, son. Make me a promise. Right now. Protect your sister. No matter what happens, the two of you should always have each other's backs. Naruto then hears footsteps of someone else. Oh, looks like we left one. Naruto's dad tries to stand up and protect his son, but Naruto's rage is then boiling. It releases in the form of ice spikes that shoot through the man's chest, sending him out of the home and pinning him to a tree in the forest miles away. The last thing Naruto's father sees with his blurred vision is his son standing tall as he dies with a smile on his face. Haku runs into the home. Naruto, are you okay? He doesn't respond, just still looking forward at what he did. She then turns to see her dead parents and falls to her knees. Mom. She runs to their sides crying, and Naruto sees something else. He walks over, and then he sees a leaf shinobi headband, picking it up. This is who did this to them. I'll kill them all for what they did. We know you're in there, a voice would say. You retired shinobi from the bingo book. If you come out willingly, we won't hunt down your kids. Outside the home stood multiple leaf shinobi Anbu. Haku looked up to Naruto, saying they have to run, and Naruto makes a fist. I'll kill them all for what they did. She begins to notice the roots of Naruto's hair. They were turning white, and he extends his hand forward. Haku stops her brother from using an attack and tells him to calm down. What did Dad tell us every time he trained us? The more calm and composed you are in battle, the stronger you will become, and you'll have an advantage over your opponent. This gets Naruto to calm down, having memories of his father, and he follows his sister's plan. Naruto takes the bodies of their parents outside through the back door where no one was. And now, when the shinobi entered the home, they all looked around, but are met by Haku. They attack her, but only shatter an ice mirror inside the home. The two siblings then stood on either side of the house with their hands extended on the walls. Ice spikes were then created on the inside of the home that stabbed through each of the shinobi inside. Naruto then walks in, ripping off the mask of one of the men, who is still somehow alive. He coughs up blood, looking into the vengeful eyes of the boy. You blood-hungry little brat. Who sent you to kill my parents? I can't tell you that. Why not? You really know nothing of loyalty to a village, kid. Naruto grabs a kunai from his pocket and slits the shinobi's throat. No, it looks like I don't at all. Haku walks in, seeing Naruto put more supplies into his backpack. We need to leave. Dad said I have to protect you. You're kidding, Naruto. This is our home. We've already killed them, so let's clean up and start over. Haku, think about it. If they don't return to their village, more will be sent here, and we need to be gone before they get here and cover our tracks. Haku's eyes widen, looking down at her brother, who seemed like a completely different person now that their parents were gone. She then remembers what Naruto just said. He talked to their father in his final moments, as she would ask, just what could have been said that would have this major change on him? Naruto and Haku bury their parents and disappear into the snowy night. The two travel through the blizzard, barely making it through, and as they travel, Naruto hears those very same roars from his dream. Just what is making that noise? Naruto turns to a different direction than his sister was going, but she grabs his hand. We have to stay together. The two then travel for a while until they're found by a rogue shinobi. Zabuza, the demon of the mist, looks down at the two kids and attacks them for their supplies as he had none. Naruto creates an ice wall to stop Zabuza, but he appears behind Haku, holding a kunai to her throat. The only reason he was able to do so was because Haku was giving most of the supplies to her brother, so at least he could survive if she did not. Hand it all over, kid, or she dies. Naruto, listen to him. No. I'm tired of listening to people. I want to do things my own way. And he's not going to kill you. I won't let him. Naruto and Zabuza lock eyes, with him noticing something different about the boy. In front of Naruto, now stood a mysterious silhouette of a giant bear with white eyes. Naruto demanded to know what this creature was, as it would only roar at him and charge him. Naruto on the outside goes into a complete berserk state. Before Zabuza could even blink, his shoulder was impaled with ice and he dropped Haku. He then flips away, but Naruto was seen behind him. He gets a quick glance at the boy's new appearance. His hair was completely white, as he had dark frost markings around his face and his neck. And his eyes, they had completely taken a new shape and color, with them being even lighter than blue. It was almost a cyan type of color. But Zabuza could feel this power, as it even made him shake. He had no time to think, as his back would be scratched by Naruto's ice claws. Haku's eyes widen as she gets flashbacks to their mother. The two of them were making lunch inside while Naruto was sparring with their father in the backyard. Doesn't Naruto know he can't beat our father? Haku then hears giggles, turning to her mother. Well, not right now. Naruto is very special. You were born a prodigy as well, Haku. A natural talent. As you are different from the people around you. Naruto? Well, his talents are great, but a lot less than your own. However, his determination and work ethic is what makes him stronger than those around him. Me and your father came across something astonishing while I was pregnant with your little brother. You were, of course, at home with the babysitter while we were traveling. What was it, Mom? It was a large bear with white fur and glowing eyes, with strange dark markings around its body. It smacked your father away and knocked him out, and then stepped towards me. I remember it very clearly. I thought it was going to eat me, but all it did was place its head on my stomach. My stomach then glowed for a moment, as the bear would then vanish into the snowy night, and by the time your father woke up, Naruto had already been born. I couldn't believe my eyes at all. His hair was as white as the fur on the creature, and his eyes, the color they were gorgeous. As he grew up, this appearance would change, but I believe that bear chose Naruto in some way. Mom, you can't be serious. It's true. Ask your father, but keep it a secret away from Naruto. I don't want his head to get any bigger. Haku and her mother would laugh as she looked forward at this battle that was going on in front of her, to see Zabuza completely being overwhelmed by Naruto. His ice release was in its most potent state. Naruto went in for the kill, but Haku stepped right in front of him and hugged Naruto. It's okay, Naruto. You beat him. You won, so you can stop. Naruto tries to release himself, but his vision begins to clear up, and he sees his sister crying. His hair slowly fades back to its darker color, and his eyes return to their normal state as well. I beat him, right? Yeah, Naruto. You did good. The two siblings get up and look down at Zabuza, who was on the ground covered in blood. They pick up their bags and walk by him. But Naruto turns around. I'm gonna kill him. Wait, Naruto. No. He'll remember us and then come for us. We have to. What if he finds the shinobi that are looking for us? Then we'll have even more enemies, and I have a feeling he'll be even stronger then. Haku wants to stop Naruto, but he's right. She watches her brother walk over to him, picking up the executioner's blade. He places his hand on the hilt, and Zabuza laughs. Kid, there's no way you can lift a blade that's bigger than you. To his shock, Naruto throws it over his shoulder, smiling, and kills Zabuza. I hate when people underestimate me. I'm the son of my father, one of the greatest warriors I've ever seen. The two siblings then make it out of the blizzard and run into a town that's pretty run down, as not many people would live here. It was peaceful though, and seems to be far away from any village or shinobi. Plus, it was hidden by the constant snow of the land. The two siblings ran out of an apartment room, and Haku notices Naruto was reading about something. What are you reading? I stole it from that man's bag. It's called the Bingo Book. It has a whole lot of different shinobi and their bounties. We killed Zabuza, so if we go collect the bounty, we'll get a lot of money. Right, sis? She looks in it, and then at her brother. Do you know what this means, Naruto? It means if we become strong enough, we can live here without any worries at all, and we can collect enough money for this town and make it our own. The two then make a promise to make this small town even better, as a time skip would then happen. It's a long enough time skip for Naruto and Haku to now both be teenagers, as their strength was that of Jonin Shinobi, with Naruto's possibly being higher. The townspeople view them as heroes because they've brought a golden age to this town. Not only that, but they were also the protectors of it. Naruto over the years has become more serious like their father, but still had his playful side when in battle. Haku was the one who picked their targets, as she could best analyze their current strength and what they could accomplish. Their next target was a man named Gato in the Land of Waves. Hearing that, Naruto laughed. I remember him. He was in the Bingo Book before, but he had a pretty low bounty. What is it at now? Haku reads off the number and Naruto's jaw drops. Well, what are we waiting on? Let's move. Haku smirks, getting up. We better before anyone else gets there. The two then say goodbye to their home and the people as they would head out, as the townspeople wish them luck. It takes them a week and a half to reach the Land of Waves, and when they begin hunting down Gato, it's pretty simple actually, because he doesn't cover his tracks at all. Their final clues lead them to the bridge that was being built by the townspeople, where Gato and his men were confronting shinobi. Two figures in hoods would appear and create a wall of ice between the shinobi and Gato, as they would jump on the other side where Gato and his men were. Gato looks forward with his heart dropping. He knows who these two are. The Frost Twins have come to collect his bounty. Naruto begins walking forward with his hands in his pocket, telling his sister to make sure that those shinobi stay out of his way. Haku nods and turns around to see the ice being melted by Kakashi and Sasuke. Who are you two? It doesn't matter. We've only come to collect Gato's bounty. Kakashi nods and steps in front of his team to protect them. Haku then notices their headbands. It would be best for you to leave. If my partner sees those headbands, there's no telling what he'll do. Kakashi wanted to question this, but can't even focus right now because of how cold it's become. Team 7 then looks forward, seeing the other hooded figure walk through the men, freezing them with just his steps alone. Naruto walks in front of Gato and pulls out the executioner's blade from his back. He then cuts off the man's head and picks it up as he freezes the bottom of it to stop the blood from dripping out. He looks around to see most of the men petrified with fear, not knowing what to do. And Naruto takes off his hood. Man, you guys really are cowards. He stomps his foot to the ground as ice spikes then shoot through each of the men standing there and sending them off of the bridge. He looks forward at his sister and then sees the shinobi behind her. He sees what headbands they were wearing as he begins to walk that way. Naruto tosses over the head to Haku and walks by Kakashi. The jonin turns around to kick Naruto, but is blocked by his blade. Naruto then walks over to Minma, the kid with the yellow hair and blue eyes, picking him up by his hair. Ouch! I'll make you pay. Shadow clone jutsu. All the clones are created, but are frozen quickly by Naruto. Minma? Well, he looks forward not knowing what would happen, but he's put down. You're just like me. That means our paths are forever intertwined with each other. What's your name? Minma Uzumaki. Alright then, Minma. Become strong, so one day, you can protect everything you love, just like me. I can tell, that beast inside of you will cause a great difficulty in your journey. Naruto then walks over to Kakashi. I have a question for you as well. If you lie, or withhold any information, I'll kill those kids behind me. Kakashi then watches as Haku places them in the crystal ice mirrors. 7 years ago, the Leaf Village attacked my own town, hidden by the snow. They killed my mother and father. It was an Anbu mission. I know because I was the one to kill them. I want to find the man who sent them there, as I've already killed the man who I believe killed my father, but I want to kill the man who's responsible. Kakashi knows he can't give up this information, but his team is at a risk. The man you were looking for goes by the name Danzo Shimura. Thanks. Haku, let him go. We're leaving. The mirrors vanish, and the two hooded figures do so as well. Days later in the Leaf Village, they would enter, and shinobi immediately come that way. The two figures are taken to the office of the Hokage, where they present the blade of Zabuza Momochi and the head of Tazuna. After collecting their bounties, the two would leave. Haku asks why they don't take Danzo down right now, but Naruto shakes his head. I have a feeling he's stronger than me. Instead, the two head somewhere else. As they were traveling back home, they were confronted by two other people, a masked man and another with orange hair and purple eyes. Haku raised her guard, but Naruto stepped in front of her. Leave my sister out of this. What do you want? If it's money, you can have it. Pain then speaks. Join the Akatsuki. What's in it for us? We won't destroy the town that the two of you hold close in your hearts. Hearing this, Naruto and Haku raise their guards. Naruto looks at the masked man and sees the Sharingan for the first time. What makes you two think I can't kill you right now? Tobi begins laughing and tells them that they're out of their league. Naruto smirks, saying he knows, but he still would try. But if they touch anyone in that town, he'll give them hell. Pain nods as the two vanish from the forest. Haku tells her brother that this isn't good, but Naruto states he has a plan. They return home weeks later and notice how their small town has grown over the years. It makes the two smile, but they know they have to leave and become even stronger than they are now for Naruto's plan to work. Haku decides she wants to return to the doctor from their childhood to learn more about their Kage Genkai, and Naruto says he's going to follow the roars that he hears in his mind. The siblings agree to meet back here in 2 years. And for the first time in their life, they separate. Naruto follows the roars and notices the closer he gets, the stronger his ice abilities become. It leads him to a cave hidden by the blizzard, so he heads inside without any second thoughts. Naruto keeps walking and finds bones of different creatures everywhere. A voice then reveals itself through the silence of this cave and the dripping water from the ceiling. "So you finally arrived, my child." A giant bear, covered by ice accents on his joints, would appear, and a dark marking on its body, stares down at Naruto. "What the hell are you?" Naruto wants to move, but just being by this polar bear, it freezes him. "Why are you scared? Don't you know who you are? I'm Naruto Yuki, the avenger of my clan and my father. So it's rage that consumes your body. That won't do at all. For you to become my successor, you must be at peace with your mind and soul. Come, boy. Your training must begin now." "No. Just what the hell are you? And why did you call me your child? I only have one father, and he was killed a long time ago. I only came to get stronger and avenge him." The bear roars at Naruto, sending him into a wall. Some of the ice from the ceiling falls down on him, and the bear smirks. He steps towards the knocked-out Naruto and places one of its sharp claws on his forehead. Naruto glowed for a moment, and was then thrown on the back of the creature. Naruto sees the memories of the days before his birth, and then, this creature is the one that attacked his parents. Naruto wakes up after seeing himself born with white hair and dark markings on his body. He sat up and was buried in snow. He looks around to his left to only see water, as he looks to his right to only see the same thing. He stood up, noticing he was on a small piece of ice. But then, he was in the middle of nowhere. Naruto heard something in the water and turned that way to see a large fin beginning to circle his ice. What is that? Naruto got in a fighting stance, trying to figure out a way out. In the distance, he could see another piece of ice. The giant aquatic creature reveals itself, slamming down on Naruto's ice, but the teen jumps off just in time, holding out his hand to the raging water. He creates a wall of ice behind him, and then runs across the water, flipping onto another ice raft. "Damn, that thing's huge. It doesn't seem like I'm going to be able to run for long either. So let's try to kill it." Naruto's hair slowly begins to fade from its darker color to white as his eyes gain their unique pattern. From afar, on a larger piece of ice, the polar bear stood with the penguin. "Velmon, do you truly believe this boy is right to be your successor?" "Yes, Skipper. I've watched him for a while now. He grows stronger throughout each battle. His only problem is his rage. He thinks his strength comes from his anger, but it is much more than that. I just hope all of this training will prove to be useful for my son." Skipper, the small penguin, chuckles, with Velmon questioning this. "I haven't seen you this excited since that day you helped the Leaf Village hold off the Ninetales." Velmon looks forward towards Naruto. "That day was quite interesting, wasn't it? Me and Kurama do have a questionable history, but he is much stronger than me. I wonder if that will cause distance between the two beings that we have chosen." Our time skip happens here, as we see Haku waiting in their hometown village. Well, the village that they started to grow up in and help. She hears footsteps and turns around to see a taller, much more muscular figure walking towards her with no shirt at all. He has some scars on his body, and his white hair flowed through the breeze and the snow. Naruto walked to his sister, hugging her. "Naruto, is that really you?" "Of course it is." The two catch up for a while, and then head out on their journey. By the time they arrive in the Leaf Village, it had already been destroyed by pain. Menma hadn't arrived yet, but two more figures did. Danzo was trying to hide, to figure out what he would do, but he became surrounded by ice, He tried to escape through another pathway, but that was also blocked off. From in front of him, Haku and Naruto began walking forward. Let's make this quick. They killed Danzo and released the ice barrier. Haku turns to her brother, seeing him have no reaction to their revenge. But she felt even better knowing their parents' killer was dead. How do you feel? Naruto looks to her smiling. It feels good knowing that he can't do that to any more kids like us. Now, let's help this place out. Wait, Naruto. I thought you hated Shinobi. No. Through my journey, I've come to realize. I just hate the old ways of the Shinobi that the new generation continues to follow. The six paths of pain rampaged throughout the city, but were all frozen in different sections by Naruto. Sakura looked up seeing this, figure defending them. But she was grabbed and taken away by Haku. Wait a minute. I remember you from when I was a kid. Yeah, and I'd never forget this beautiful pink hair. She dropped off Sakura, far away, and then looked towards the battle, wishing her brother luck. Pain and the other paths break free from the ice, questioning Naruto and why he was doing this. I've had enough of living in fear when I'm clearly stronger than who I fear. One of the paths sneak up behind Naruto, trying to rip his soul from him. But as soon as his hand makes contact with Naruto's head, it freezes and breaks off. Naruto side-eyes this path of pain, kicking its head off. Then he dodges another attack from the Diva path. There's no possible way you can defeat me alone. I never said I was going to be the one to defeat you. But don't you think I'm pretty good at buying time? Menma would arrive here with the toes and jump down. He blasted two paths of pain with a Rasengan, looking at Naruto. Who are you? For today, I'm an ally of this village. You're quite skilled to master toad senjutsu at that age. Fukusaku, who was on the shoulder of Menma, looked towards Naruto, with his eyes widening. Menma, this battle could end much quicker if you decided to become his ally. Fukusaku, are you saying he's strong enough to even help me? Listen, Menma. The person standing before you also has sage jutsu. It's only a different form of it. Menma looks to Naruto, who is in a battle stance. The one in the middle is pain. I'll clear you a path. Just make sure you win. Menma nods and thanks Naruto. The two rush forward with immense speeds, and Naruto creates, well, he separates each path of pain with ice. You idiot. You're not supposed to say thanks until we win the battle. All six paths of pain were divided into each section. Naruto jumps forward towards the human path, catching it off guard. He places his hand in his mouth, causing ice to make it explode from the inside. Naruto looks across, seeing the Praetor path jump through the ice as he would dodge its attacks and sends wave of ice that completely obliterates it. Naruto then looks up, and he dodges the Naraka path, kicking it back. Let's see if you can deal with this. He places his hand in the air as ice spikes are created and fly down on this path of pain. It would narrowly avoid it, but then notices it's surrounded by these sharp ice pillars. It then looks forward at Naruto after realizing, but it was too late. The ice spikes then froze the ground around below its feet and completely encased it in sort of an ice sand coffin type of attack, and then crushed it. Naruto then looked around. Alright, not too bad. He looks up, seeing the animal path summon animals that destroy the ice. Oh, so that's how we're gonna fight. Well, I don't mind. I was going to save this form, but why not show off a little bit? Naruto turns into a giant polar bear with ice accents all over his shoulders and claws. The animals would rush this bear, but with only one swipe, they would rip through, and the animal path is soon crushed after. Naruto reverts to his human form and gets to see the final moments of the battle between Pain and Menma. Naruto leaves, going to find his sister, and the two would depart from the village. Sakura asks them to wait, but Haku turns, saying their paths will cross again. She's certain. After defeating Pain, Menma looked for Naruto, but could not sense him at all. A couple months would go by as we now were in the final moments of the fourth great shinobi war, or what seemed like it. Menma was being healed, and the Ten Tails was summoned. Two figures then arrived just before the Hokage. Ice walls divide the army from the enemy, and Menma smirks. Naruto turns back looking at him. It's about time you two arrived. Yeah, well, we had to make a detour on the way here. Haku and Naruto are seen with serious expressions, as here we get a flashback, well, flashback images, of them fighting their parents, who were revived. After defeating them, the family has a moment of peace, and this motivated Naruto even further. So, Menma, what do you need me to do? Just hold them off until I'm ready. That's all. I could do that in my sleep. Naruto rushes forward, charging Madara, who jumps down to face him. Naruto throws a punch, but is dodged, and Madara swings his own fist. Naruto vanishes, appearing behind Madara, kicking him, sending him skidding on the ground. So this is who competed with the God of Shinobi. The dust clears as it's revealed that Madara blocked his attack. Not half bad. You might have given me a little warm-up. Madara and Naruto rush towards each other once again, shocking the five Hokage, who were just barely alive. Naruto throws a punch that's evaded, but dodges the next strike of Madara. Naruto swings his leg once again, but Madara sees through this attack. However, as he goes to dodge, he can't. Looking down, he sees that his legs were already frozen. Naruto lands a strike, this time sending him flying even further, and as he floated through the air, he created larger ice spikes that chased right after Madara. Madara used his fan to stop his movement and created a fire-style jutsu, sending it towards the ice. He looked forward to see his opponent was no longer there. Suddenly, the ground below him turned to ice and shot him into the sky, as now he was standing on about 30 feet of ice as he looked behind him to see Naruto. What an impressive Kekkeigenkai. You've mastered it to its fullest. Still, it can't compare to that of Hashirama. Naruto smirks. And neither can you. The Uchiha scoffs, rushing at Naruto, taking him even more seriously. Even with his bear-like sage mode, Naruto was defeated. Madara seen holding him by his head as he was dripping blood. What do you have to say for yourself? Naruto then smirks. I think I buy time better than anyone else. Madara's eyes widen as he's kicked away by Tobirama and Hashirama. Naruto's body falls to the ground and Haku runs over. Naruto, don't worry, I'll be fine. It's about time they showed up. I could sense their chakra far away. I just needed to stall a little bit longer. Haku calls her brother an idiot and Sakura runs over, beginning to heal him. From here, the war arc continues the same, with Team 7 still defeating Kaguya and breaking the infinite Tsukuyomi. After the war is when we see Haku and Naruto returning to their smaller village that they helped establish. And here is where the story of Naruto Yuki ends. I really hope you guys enjoyed this one. The script was much faster than I thought, as I don't think this is a pretty long video when I'm recording. But I didn't want it to be a very long story, as I already had an outline of how I wanted it to go and how I wanted it to end. This wasn't supposed to be a usual story of a main character either. I wanted this to feel like one of those side characters that you love in anime, who gets his own arc that has heavy details within it that makes you fall in love with the character even more. I feel like some of you may have questions about the bear and where the idea came from. The idea of Velmon was inspired from Norwegian folklore, and it was the White Bear King, Velmon, or that's what the original story was named. I researched it just a little bit and added Velmon to the story, but I changed a lot of his origin. Speaking of that, I didn't even get to explain that within the story, as I didn't feel like it would be needed within the story. I feel like it would be better for me to say it after. Velmon in this story was raised by the Sage of Six Paths from a small cub as a pet, but granted a small amount of chakra that grew over time, and that's how he became so powerful. Anyway, if you like this story, consider leaving a like and even subscribing so you don't miss content like this on my channel. This is Zero, and I'll catch you all on the next one.